today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free one-week trial. Just $4.99 a month for your all-access pass. Playing now on Fandor is Opeka, an iron-willed Argentine priest inspires hope for an entire nation by teaching people living in Madagascar's largest landfill to build a highly functional city in their failing African country.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome to the Fandor Video Podcast. My name is Hooman. To my right is Chris Kelly.
How welcome, you doing, Chris. Hey.
Go Giants.
Go Giants.
And our amazing producer, Bryn.
So good to be here. I'm so honored.
All right. So we have a very special guest. Bryn is very young compared to Chris and I, but Chris and I grew up watching this woman for years and years. You know her as Elvira, Mistress of the Dark, but everyone else knows her as Cassandra Peterson. Welcome to the show, Cassandra.
Hi. Yes. Thank you. Good to be here with you.
Oh my God, it's an honor. Just because we're so used to associating you with Halloween, and Halloween is literally
around the corner.
Literally around the corner, and I feel like the timing of this interview is perfect. Cassandra, listen, I'm looking at you, and can you remind me how old are you again? 70 years old. And I think we should start off with, what's your skincare regimen? Like, how have you aged so well?
I don't know, but let me tell you, if I had some magic potion, you can be damn sure I'd be slapping my brand all over it and selling it. I can't tell you really, but I mean, maybe I attribute it to, I had a pretty healthy diet. I exercise a lot. And,
what about facials?
Do you get facials?
Do you get facials?
Oh, I thought you said, what about facial hair? Let's not go there. I wish I was a guy and I could grow a beard. That would be so much easier. Damn. I do. I get facials. I get massages. I try to take really good care of myself. I mean, I always have. And honestly, I think one of the keys to staying younger is enjoying what you do, enjoying your work. You know, I really do. I think I look around at other people who are old and who look great, and I think they really enjoy what they do.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So for some reason, I was under the impression that you worked yourself to death, but it seems like you really care about... you work yourself to death and you care about self-care, both.
I do. Okay. No, and like I said, if you love your work, then it's not really work, you know?
Yeah,
but I mean,
right.
Not that I love it every single day when I have to get up at 5 a.m. to do an interview or something. I'm not loving it so much right at that point. Mm-hmm. But in general, I really, really love doing the character.
Well, and just for our watchers and listeners, it's the middle of the afternoon now, or it's early afternoon. We didn't get her up at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. I did that this morning. Yeah, Don't worry.
Let's talk about your book, Yours Cruelly, New York Times bestseller. Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
What's your hope for people to take away after reading your book? Like, what do you want them to walk away with?
Well, honestly, I hope that they have fun reading it. I hope it's interesting and exciting, but honest to God, I hope that it is a little bit inspirational to people out there, especially kids who grew up possibly feeling like they didn't fit in or were bullied and teased. That's how I grew up, because I was burned as a child, and I was made fun of and... teased my whole childhood. And I write about that quite a bit in the book. And I just hope that people see that those obstacles that are in their way can be overcome and you can keep moving forward. So I really hope it's a little inspirational to people. And I've gotten a little feedback that from people who say, wow, I this gave me so much hope for myself.
That's beautiful. Well, remind me what year you moved to Vegas?
1969, the same year I graduated high school.
Wow.
So you immediately went to Vegas. And so you had an encounter with Elvis.
I did.
Tell us about that encounter. How did it happen? Where did it happen? And like, what was the exchange between you two?
Yeah, it's so bizarre because I've always sort of said it was a date with Elvis. It wasn't a date. It was, I was 17 at the time, and he came and saw the show I was in, which was called Viva La Girls. And he invited some of the showgirls back for a party that he was having at his suite. And I went. I was so excited because I was a huge Elvis fan since I was like 5 years old. Mm-hmm. And he sort of glommed onto me, probably because I was 17, you know, and everybody else there were probably in their 30s. And
he did have that reputation.
Yeah, well, but nothing really happened. Well, first of all, I was 17. Okay, I think that is one explanation why nothing really happened. And he had plenty of handlers and his manager and everybody there at the party. So, you know, that was part of it. But we just started talking in the evening, like around 2 a.m. when I got off work, until about 10 a.m. the next morning, talking and talking and talking. And he gave me his whole philosophy about life and some incredible advice, which was basically get the hell out of Vegas. You're too young to be here. Hmm. And I took his advice and it really did change my life. I always tell people, at that time, I was the youngest showgirl in Hollywood. And if it wasn't for Elvis Presley, I would now be the oldest showgirl in Las Vegas.
What else?
Amazing. Before I met in Las Vegas.
Do you remember what else you guys talked about during that 8 hours?
Yeah, we talked about everything. His life and his wife, who he was in the process of divorcing. And his daughter. We talked about a major thing that really changed my outlook on everything was he told me a bunch of advice about astrology, numerology, spirituality, and gave me all kinds of suggestions and advice. He wrote down in the book, I have the letter that he wrote to me. He just was making notes on the back of an old letter he had sent to his dad, Vernon Presley. And he wrote a bunch of notes about spirituality, not religion, but spirituality. It turns out that Elvis, if you kind of research that, he was a very, very spiritual guy. And I've since talked to so many people who have met Elvis, and he gave them books about his belief system, which has turned into be my belief system now. And that is basically the law of attraction, that you kind of get what you ask for.
Wow.
So anyway, it was a very, very, very enlightening night. And I did get to kiss him. That was awesome.
Oh, well, there we go.
How long did you guys kiss for?
Well, we were doing a few little kisses here and there, but at the end, it was just one long, big goodnight kiss. And it was, I was fainting. I was about to pass out. All I could think in my head was, oh my God, I'm kissing Elvis. I'm kissing Elvis. You know, I wasn't in the moment, really. I was just thinking about, I can't wait to tell everybody. I think that's what I was thinking.
Of course.
Was this your one and only encounter with Elvis?
It was, unfortunately. I always wished and hoped that someday again, I could meet him again and thank him for changing my life, mm-hmm. Which he really did. And that, unfortunately, was not to be. Mm-hmm. And it was weird. It was weird because he gave me a big, gigantic, long anti-drug speech.
Oh, interesting.
And then he ironically died of a drug overdose. Yeah. Kind of drug thing. Right.
Did you follow his advice on drugs?
No.
Thank you for your honesty. Thank you for your honesty.
Yeah, thank you. So, I still smoke a little weed. Once now and then. I don't do major drugs, but come on now.
Not like the good old days, right?
Yeah.
No. All right. So I heard another interview with you, and it seems like horror movies have been part of your life since you were like in second grade. And you talk about this horror movie you watched in second grade, but in all the interviews I watched, you never revealed the title. What was the first horror movie you watched?
It was House on Haunted Hill with Vincent Price.
There we go.
Oh my God. That had such a huge impact on me.
Yeah,
I love that film. I just hosted it actually for Shudder about a week ago. It's on streaming right now.
I've seen some of the promos. It's been great to see that.
Yep. My favorite movie.
What was the circumstance? Like, where was it showing? How did you see it? Like, tell us that.
Okay. It was showing in Colorado Springs, Colorado, where I lived as a child. My cousin Danny took me. I don't know if it was because he, wanted me to go to the movies with him, or he was a lot older than me, or he just had, felt sorry for me, but he took me to the movie and I freaking loved it. I mean, I was both completely repelled and also totally fascinated. I went home. I remember having horrible nightmares of Vincent Price chasing me with a butcher knife all night long. I had those dreams over and over. My parents kicked my cousin's ass because he took me to the movie.
Oh, that's hilarious.
And, I mean, literally.
Isn't that the nature of horror movies, though, that they're both sort of compelling and repelling at the same time, that there's this terror?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. You know, you don't want to see it in the same time. You want to see more. I mean, that's how it was for me anymore. And I still kind of feel that way. It's kind of like you're watching something and going.
Exactly. That peak is critical.
Yeah.
All right. Listen, this is something I used to do with other celebrities I've interviewed in the past, and you're the first one we're going to be doing it with on Fandor. It's called The Rumor Mill. I'm going to ask you questions that I've read about you. You tell me if these are true or false, and you can say no comment, but I'd really like you to answer them. Okay. So you were good friends with Vincent Price all the way till his death. True or false?
True. Okay. We have many, many letters that we wrote back and forth to each other. I heard there's one in the Smithsonian Institute. I don't know if that's true, but that's what I heard.
You're still good friends with Rob Zombie.
Great friends with Rob. Even better friends with him. I just love him and Sherry. They've become really good friends. Yes.
You were the stripper in the background on the cover of the Tom Waits album Small Changes in 1976.
Okay. I really thought that could have been me too. Everybody said that was me, but I didn't remember ever doing it. And I thought, really? I mean, I know I forget a lot of things, but would you really forget like being on an album cover of Tom Waits, you know? So I looked at the picture. It looked very similar to me, but I saw a few little things I didn't think were me. And eventually someone wrote to me and said that that was their girlfriend. She was a stripper at Jumbo's Clown Room here in Hollywood. That's a real place. Oh, and nice. And he gave me her name. I don't remember her name now, but he said that was his girlfriend at the time. And she got that gig and that was her. So it is not me. I'm sad to say.
Wow. You auditioned for the role of Ginger on Gilligan's Island.
I did. And I basically got the role. It was a Gilligan's Island remake. And I got the part and then I lost the part. After I was already packing up to go to Hawaii to shoot it and had my script and had my costumes all ready and everything, they ended up giving it to another girl. Kind of a long story. You have to read about it in my book. Too long to tell here.
Okay. Another reason to read the book.
Uh-huh. Yeah. There you go.
Is it true that your two favorite movies of all time are Plan 9 from Outer Space and Attack of the Killer Tomatoes? Is that really true?
No.
Okay, thank you. I read that and I'm like, those are so mediocre.
But I know.
Attack of the Killer Tomatoes, a George Clooney debut. Like, that's what everybody forgets about Attack of the Killer Tomatoes.
Oh, my God. Is that really?
Yeah, George Clooney was in Attack of the Killer Tomatoes.
I have to say, I really do love Plan 9 from Outer Space. I mean, it really sucks, but I do love it. But I really do not love Attack of the Killer Tomatoes.
It's a terrible movie, but it's funny because it's so campy. Right.
And when I aired it on my show, you know, I wrote jokes about how bad the movie was, but they had already written all their jokes. So there wasn't really anything to say. All the jokes about tomato sauce and ketchup had been taken, you know, already. So it was a horrible movie to host.
Can you tell us three or four of your favorite movies of all time? I mean, this is a podcast for an independent streaming site, and I couldn't find anywhere where you talk about, even if they're romantic comedies, just any movies that you really loved.
Well, I'm going to tell you the movies that completely changed my life.
Yes.
And that I thought about so much that I actually kind of reenacted the movies later. Well, one was House on Haunted Hill. Mm-hmm. Luckily, I did not reenact that. But I had a very strange experience at that actual house in the Hollywood Hills where I met Christopher Lee, who was shooting The Howling 2 at that time.
Okay.
Two was Viva Las Vegas with Elvis Presley and Anne Margaret. And that movie changed my life. I mean, I saw that movie and said, that's where I want to be, Las Vegas. I want to be a showgirl. So totally changed my life. The other one was Sweet Charity. These are really old movies, guys, okay? Nobody was born back then. But it was just one of my favorite movies. It starred Shirley MacLaine and Cheetah Rivera and a bunch of people. And I sort of ended up living out that movie, too, when I lived in Italy, and not in a good way. And then let's see.
Well, do you want to expand on what that means? Not in a good way? Like, do you want to tell us what that means?
Well, I ended up being a dime a dance girl at a bar in Italy. Okay. And that is not a fun job. It really sucks. People come in and pay you, buy tickets to dance with you. It's like more like a wrestling match. Because they dance with you and you're like, oh, no. So that was a really sucky job. But the movie Sweet Charity was about a bunch of dime a dance girls. And so there I was living that movie again.
Anything else?
And, well, Elvira, Mistress of the Dark.
Yeah, we saw that. Yeah. We saw that in the theaters.
Yep.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
And obviously that changed my life because it kind of put me on the, calendar there, whatever the hell that means. I don't know. Made my awareness grow quite a bit.
Yeah. Right.
All right. So I'm going to ask this question gingerly. Cautiously, and I hope you answer. Were you more than friends with Jimmy Page, Tom Jones, and Jimi Hendrix?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but
all right.
Well, I don't know what you say, more than friends, but yes, I had little encounters with all three of them.
Can you say they were flirtation? Were they flirtation? Oh, many more?
Yeah. Well, I couldn't get into the whole list in my book because the book, I didn't want to be as long as the Bible. But anyway, I was kind of a groupie back then. My hair is driving me crazy. Sorry, guys. I got this.
That looks fantastic.
Yeah, you look fantastic.
Yeah, you're amazing. Okay. Sorry.
Let's go back to these three guys, Jimmy Page, Tommy Jones, and Jimi Hendrix. If you wouldn't mind, which one of the three's company did you enjoy the most?
Good question.
Jimi Hendrix
and Tom Jones.
Oh, Jimi Hendrix. Awesome. Definitely.
Why? Tell us why.
He was sweet and kind and cared about me. I had just been hit in the head with a tear gas canister. He was taking care of me and getting a washcloth and ice and putting it on my head and being so incredibly sweet. And we stayed in his trailer right before he went to perform at the Denver, it was a Denver pop festival back in 68, 69. And he was a doll. We kissed, we made out, we smoked weed. And then he went on to do his show. And he couldn't have been more sweet and caring and interesting. We're talking about politics. I didn't know anything about politics at that time, but he did, just the state of the United States at that time during the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. And it was really, really fantastic. The other two guys, it was not such a fun time, but I still love Jimmy Page. I got to tell you, I love Jimmy Page so much.
Oh, can we talk about that or should we move on to the next question?
Well, you can talk about it. I met him when he was in the Yardbirds.
Oh, okay.
That's how long
ago
that was.
Before
wow.
The zap, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, which was one of the best damn bands in the whole world. And yeah. I mean, he's just one of the best guitarists in the world. And I'm a music freak and I respect him so much. And I wish I could have had a better kind of... what would you call it? Run in with them than it was. But it was very brief. I was way too young. He was, I think, a little out of it, perhaps. And so it wasn't that fun. But I was thrilled to meet him in any case.
Oh, wow. You know what's so great about you? You are so positive. No matter what happens, you say it with a smile.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm going to throw you a curveball question that nobody has ever asked you ever.
Oh,
but you
are
did
you sure?
Yeah, I'm 100% sure.
Uh-oh.
You mentioned the Bible just a second ago. What's your favorite Bible verse?
Oh, I do have a favorite. Let's see.
Here we go.
I forgot it. But,
well, say it. I can help you figure it
out. Is it the 14th Psalm?
Okay.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Is that the 14th?
Amen. Oh, yeah. Bravo. Yeah.
And oh, I actually do know the whole thing, but I can't think of it right now. But
has anyone else?
That was drilled into my head when I was in Sunday school, when I was a kid. And
Bible verses with Elvira, Mistress of the Dark, was something that, yes, that was not exactly the plan theme for this, but here we are.
It's needed.
I think it's still a really great song. I love singing. I like everything that it says in there. And I thought at the time Goodness and Mercy were two dogs, I don't know why, that looked like Lassie. And I always thought that they're following me the rest of my life. And I thought, that's so awesome. I have these two dogs following me.
Has anyone ever asked you that question before?
No, you are right.
Ta-da!
You are right. Yay, the first time I've got asked a question that nobody else has asked.
I want to ask you two more questions. This next one is... I'm gonna dive deep here. I want to talk to you about your mom, and I don't want you to cry.
Okay, I hope it's not another Bible verse question, because that's my only one that I know.
By the time we interview you next time, you better have another Bible verse.
Okay, I'm gonna start studying now.
Okay, I know you guys had a strained relationship, and I've seen other interviews where you talk about your mom and the tears start flowing, but did you ever find out what the root cause was of your strained relationship with your mom?
Well, my mom, her mom had died when she was 9 years old. And my mom was put into a foster care system and shuttled from one home to another the rest of her childhood. And I can only imagine that it wasn't that great of an experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see.
So she had her demons, let me tell you. And she was just a very tense and anxious and angry woman. I honestly don't think she should have had kids and been married, but back then that's what you did, you know, everybody did. And she just had a hard time dealing with us three girls, and it was not pleasant. It was not pleasant. Our relationship became better as she got older, although she still drove me out of my mind most of the time. But,
did she ever tell you she was proud of you? Did you guys ever reconcile?
She has told me she was proud of me. Over the years, she was very proud of me becoming Elvira. I know that when I got famous, she was very, very happy and proud about that. Okay. As my dad was. But it gets a little more like sounding like I'm a psychologist. I won't even go there.
Okay, all right.
I know she was very proud. And she told everybody I was Elvira. And so half my life I spent signing autographed photos to her mailman's son's cousin's daughter's garbage collector. I mean, everybody she met, she would pull out my picture. This is my daughter. And then I'd end up signing photos to everyone in the world.
That's beautiful. I mean, I've never heard you talk about the reconciliation with your mom. I've only heard about the problems. So hearing that you guys got a... And then can you tell... I've never heard you say one thing about your dad. Tell us one great thing about your dad. Just one.
Oh, my dad, he was a trip. He was a man's man. I mean, he was a big tattooed guy that would kick the crap out of anybody who looked at him sideways. My dad he was just amazing. I mean, I remember even when I was in my 20s, I signed up for this gym one time in Colorado Springs because I was going to be home for a month. And they accused me of signing up for the year and sent me a bill for the entire year. And I went in with my dad and I said, you know, I only signed up for a month. That was very clear. And they go, no, you didn't. You signed up for a year. And the guy behind the desk said to my dad, did it ever occur to you, Mr. Peterson, that your daughter is a liar?
Whoa.
And my dad flew across that desk and punched the living crap out of that guy. He was crying on the ground. And then he goes, come on, Sonny, let's go. And that guy was just laying there. I mean, that's the kind of guy he was. You didn't mess with any of his family or anything. But on the other side, he was super funny and charming and great storyteller. Really funny guy.
Let's end with this. First of all, just a quick reminder. Elvira has Cassandra Peterson. Yes. Forgive me for saying that. She has a new book out.
I'm used to it. Don't worry.
Listen, when you grow up watching you, the name Cassandra never comes to mind. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, we had to ingrain it into our minds here, but I've wanted to call you Elvira 100 times during this interview. Her new book is called Yours Cruelly, and I just want to end with this last question. tell us about you and Frank Sinatra.
Ah, yes, that's a beautiful story. I met him in Vegas when I was the date of Alan Osmond, one of the Osmond brothers. Uh-huh. And we met Frank Sinatra at Nancy Sinatra's birthday party or opening of her show, I think, at Caesar's Palace. And anyway, I'm standing there with the whole Osmond family. I'm a showgirl at that time across the street at the Dunes. And Frank Sinatra shakes everybody's hand, mom and dad, Osmond, and all the seven siblings. And then he gets to me, and I extend my hand to shake it. And he puts his hand in his pocket and leans back and goes, "Nice tits." I mean,
oh.
It was in front of the Osmonds.
Yeah,
they're from
wow.
Utah.
Yeah.
They're Mormons. I mean, they've never heard that word. I was dying of
amazing.
But the only good part about that story is that many, many years later, I was working as a hat check girl in a restaurant called Emilio's in Hollywood. And Frank Sinatra came into the restaurant with his entourage, and he checked his hat with me. And while he was dining, I spit in it.
Nice.
Oh, wow.
See, revenge is better than all Christmas. Right. It was awesome. All right. I felt better after that.
Cassandra, remind us your website.
Elvira.com, and I'm on all the social medias at The Real Elvira.
All right.
Listen, thank you so much for your time. Chris, did
this
you enjoy
so,
this?
This is so fantastic. Thanks so much for joining us.
Yeah.
That was fun, you guys. That was a fun interview. And I like the Bible study question.
Absolutely.
Well, listen, I hope it encourages you to memorize one more.
Yeah, I might have to now.
That's our next interview. We're going to turn this into a new podcast series, is the Bible with Cassandra Peterson.
Oh, that's going to be super exciting. Remind me not to come back.
Okay. Thanks so much.
All right, guys.
Thank you so much.
All right, take care.
All right, take care.
Thanks.
Thanks for tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free 1-week trial. Playing now on Fandor is Opeka. An iron-willed Argentine priest inspires hope for an entire nation by teaching people living in Madagascar's largest landfill to build a highly functional city in their failing African country. That's FANDOR, the home for cinephiles.